Welcome back. In our previous lecture, we discussed about boundary layer and then the concepts about hydrodynamic theory, and also we looked at how the flow separation happens because of the adverse pressure gradient, right? Now let us look at how lift is generated. Like, what is lift? We will define what is lift and drag, right, of airfoil. Okay. So now let us consider an airfoil, which is a cross section of the wing, as most of you are aware, right? So let's place this airfoil in the flow, which means the airflow flow with a free stream velocity of v infinity, which means the airfoil is also moving at a velocity v infinity here, right? Let us assume that this flow happens in a stream tube. Okay. So now let's say this stream tube, as soon as it encounters this airfoil, right, leading edge of this airfoil, we'll talk about that, what is leading edge. Let us say it encounters the airfoil. What happens is this parent stream tube will get splitted into two daughter stream tubes. So there are many other explanations how the lift is generated. So this is one that I believe is more realistic. Right. So let us say the initial cross section area of the stream tube be A, and on the top surface let one be on the top of this airfoil, which is the top surface, and let two be the portion of this airfoil which is on the bottom side of this surface, right? So let us call it as, yeah, and then the corresponding area here is say A, you can say A1 and A2, right? So here what happens is, because of the presence of this body, the flow gets splitted across this, and then which results in a reduction in cross section area in the flow above and below the airfoil, right? So again, this flow happens again in the stream tubes. We call them as daughter stream tubes here. So A1 and A2 are less than area of the parent stream tube. Right. Since the area is reduced, what happens is the flow tries to accelerate on the top and bottom surface here. Right. That means you will have velocity V1 and V2. Right. And V1 and V2 are greater than V infinity. Can be, isn't it? So which results in a drop in the pressure, right? According to Bernoulli's theorem. Right. What happens is, so let's say P1 be the pressure at this point and P2 be the pressure on the bottom side of this airfoil, static pressure on the bottom side of this airfoil. So P1 and P2 less than the pressure in the free stream velocity, P infinity, right? Okay, static pressure in the free stream. Now, can we observe something here? So there is a drop in pressure. So there is an increase in velocity on either side of this airfoil, and at the same time there is a drop in pressure here, right? So when this drop in pressure, if P1 and P2 are equal, then there is no pressure difference, isn't it? So which means there is no net force in this vertical plane. If there is a difference in P1 and P2, say P1 is less than P2, which means there is a differential pressure in the vertical plane, and there will be a force, like the pressure, because of the static pressure on the bottom will try to push this airfoil up, right? So equivalent to the area times of pressure, static pressure acting there, and the difference of this pressure will give you, pressure times the area will give you the corresponding force, right? Am I correct or not? So that means when we have a pressure difference, we can create a force called, yeah, a force due to aerodynamics. Am I correct? Now again, this is from pressure contribution. So we also witnessed that while discussing boundary layer theory concepts, initial concepts of this boundary layer theory. So we talked about viscous flows, right? So what is viscosity doing here? It is trying to stop this body moving in this fluid. Am I correct or not? Which means it is trying to, so if say when we represent V infinity in this direction, which means the body is moving in the opposite direction, right? So the obstruction will be, because of viscosity, what will be the direction of obstructing force? Opposite to the motion, right? So due to viscosity, let us say, viscosity is acting on the surface, right? So there is a force acting on the surface, which is a, am I correct or not? So there is a surface and there is a tangential force. What we can expect is a shear stress acting in the tangential direction on the surface, right? Let tau s be, tau s represents this particular tangential stress called shear stress here, right? Fine. So when you have flow, due to viscosity, you have shear stress, and when you have flow, you have pressure distribution, isn't it? You have pressure distribution here. So this negative pressure is nothing but drop in pressure compared to the static pressure, surrounding static pressure, right? Let us assume there is no energy addition in this particular flow, right? So we have that our disc, actuator disc, attached to an aircraft near the fuselage, right? And let us assume the wings are far away from the influence of the free stream from this particular setup, right? The disc or the propeller and the engine there, right? Now this propeller is generating a thrust tree, which is now fixed, rigidly attached to the aircraft. Now the aircraft is being pulled by the, with the same force, right? And wings are rigidly attached to this aircraft, and wings also experience the same velocity, forward velocity. So in a fluid, when there is forward velocity, you have equal and opposite flow moving with equal and opposite velocity in the direction, in the opposite direction of the velocity, isn't it? Am I correct or not? So that means, so the wing which is not under the influence of this propeller, ideally the pressure far ahead is static pressure, which is the atmospheric pressure. So when it start moving, that means the static pressure, atmospheric pressure drops down, and then your dynamic pressure increases to maintain the total pressure, right, constant. So when this happens, right, that means in that particular stream tube, compared to the ambient conditions, let us say if you consider an offset distance from that particular stream tube, you have static pressure conditions. Am I correct or not? So compared to that ambient conditions, the pressure inside that stream tube, which is upstream, is less. Am I correct or not? And it is further less on the wings, right? So because the velocity is increasing here, so the pressure ambient to this is static pressure, but this pressure here, the static pressure, which is the atmospheric pressure there, but the static pressure inside this particular stream tube is far lesser. Am I correct or not? Compared to static pressure. And when compared, when we compare the pressure on the upper and bottom surface, we have higher, so this is for a typical aerofoil, right? So we have higher pressure drop on the top and lower pressure drop on the bottom part, right? So we'll see why it is once we look at the nomenclature of this aerofoil, and then we'll get back to that, right? Why there is higher pressure drop on the top and lower pressure drop on the bottom. So there is pressure drop on either side, but there is a higher pressure drop on the top and lower pressure drop on the bottom face. So that's why these arrows represent that negative pressure, that pressure drop compared to the ambient conditions, right? Pressure in the ambient conditions. Okay. So you have these two are happening together, right? Isn't it? So these two are happening together. When there is flow, there is viscosity, there is shear stress, and there is pressure, static pressure, right? And there is certain pressure distribution. So this talks about a typical pressure distribution. On airfoil, right? So figure B talks about shear stress distribution. Okay, so combining them, what we have is a resultant aerodynamic force, isn't it? So there, so this object is moving in the fluid, right? This airfoil is moving in the fluid, and it experiences pressure as well as shear stress distribution. So, and the result, as a result of this aerodynamic, right? Aerodynamics, we have a resultant aerodynamic force here. Okay. Let us say this is some reference line for the time being. So, and say this is moving in this V infinity. What do you mean by this V infinity? We are representing this entire flow field by means of this particular vector here, V infinity, which means the airfoil is actually moving in this direction. Though it is oriented in a particular fashion, but still it is moving downward, right? Let us say if there is an arrow in this direction, that means the object is moving in this particular direction, right? Now, a component of this resultant aerodynamic force, which is acting perpendicular to this V infinity, right? Say, is called lift. So we have a component from this resultant aerodynamic force which is acting perpendicular to V infinity. So V infinity and lift makes an angle 90 degrees here, right? And a component of this resultant aerodynamic force acting parallel to V infinity or along V infinity is your drag, right? So now we have defined what is lift and drag. So lift is component of resultant aerodynamic force acting perpendicular to free stream. Okay, so and drag is a component of resultant aerodynamic force which is acting in the direction of free stream. Just direction of V infinity here, right? Isn't it? So we know now drag is in this negative direction of the motion. Am I correct or not? So when we represent V infinity in this direction, which means the object is moving in this direction, and we know drag is acting in the negative direction or along free V infinity, which is the negative direction of motion. So that means drag retards the motion of this object in the fluid here, right? So let us now quickly look at what is the nomenclature of this airfoil, right? And then the lift here lift here is defined as, it's represented by L, and is defined as the dynamic pressure times half rho V square, dynamic pressure times the reference area, which in general is a wing planform area, right, times the non-dimensional lift quotient called CL here, right. So where half rho V square is known as dynamic pressure, as you are aware. And this, so Q infinity, it is represented by Q infinity. What you can say is, so Q infinity S times CL here, right? And the units of lift is newtons here, right? So units are newtons or what? Kg meter per second square, okay? And then S is the plan reference area, planform reference area. That is contributing towards lift here, right? And then CL is a non-dimensional lift coefficient. We'll see what CL depends upon, right? As we progress, we'll talk about that. Similarly, drag is defined as half rho V square, dynamic pressure times reference area times CD. CD is a non-dimensional drag coefficient. So you have S and this, which is Q infinity times S CD, where CD is equals to CD is the non-dimensional drag coefficient. Okay, thank you.